Maar dat waren dan. Wayland.
But try to understand it this way. When we say nothing happened, it's God's will, because He's the sovereign. He's the sovereign, He's in charge of every affair, but He's not the one who's responsible for people to make their choices. So when we were created as human beings, God has given us this limited amount of free will in which we can make choices. If we have no free will, then we'll be like robots. Then the question of punishing someone becomes meaningless, because you have no control over what you do. But if God gives someone freedom to act and to choose on a certain sphere of things, then if God then intervenes every time, takes away your choice, then you don't have the choice anymore. For example, you can have a knife, and you can use this knife to cut apples and fruits and vegetables and whatever to make nice fruit salad, right? Or you can use this knife to stab someone and kill someone. Now the choice is on you. God, if you were to take the choice away the moment you are going to stab someone, then obviously you didn't have any choice. You're like
robot.
So what we say is, God allows that action to happen because you are the one choosing this to happen, and the responsibility will be on you. He doesn't want you to do this. He doesn't, not you personally, he doesn't want the criminals to commit crimes. He doesn't want people to commit sins. He says, this is what you shouldn't be doing. This is not the right thing to do, not the good thing to do.
But nothing happens without His will.
Yeah. His will, yeah.
See, that's where you get into problem. You
know? If you say,
I know you can go on talking for hours and end.
Think about that people have their own will manifested by their own choice, and no one controlling it. So you're saying someone
is in control. Is he in control or not?
If God is in control, you would expect that He should be in control of their will as well when they will it to happen. Because otherwise you're saying there's two competing wills. We're saying God's will is sovereign. He doesn't like it that people will to do something wrong.
Somebody like Hitler.
No, do you follow? God doesn't wish or will or want that people use their will wrongly to do harm or injustice or oppression. He doesn't want that. He discourages people from that. He even legislates to live in a society that this is what is going to happen to people who abuse this will, the responsibility that God has given. God has given this as a trust, this free will as a trust and a responsibility that we should use it wisely, that we don't commit oppression and transgression and injustice on this land. Yeah?
You're a Muslim, are you? What do you say to critics who say the critics who say the law of Islam are based on the primitive Arab culture?
Okay. How so we would say simply, think about any laws that Islam puts forward to man's affairs, to how to conduct your life in family or in a society, right? And compare this to any situation here, now, or in the future. And compare this to any other laws that man has brought forward. And see which one is the most right. Then you can see whether this is a primitive law or not.
Now,
okay. Suppose now you have a system.
You're not an Arab, are you?
No, I'm not. To give you an example. Democracy is a very, very primitive system. Much more primitive than Islam, because it came long, hundreds and thousands of years. My friend, I think you're getting there. One second. Democracy is a system that predates Islam by thousands of years. So it's primitive in that sense. And yet people are fighting for democracy. So it's not this primitiveness or how long ago that system originated. That's not the issue. Let's come back to the discussion point here. It is not about how long ago a system was given to conduct people's life in a society. Because if it was the case, we would say democracy is outdated because it's too long ago. Yeah? So it's not about how long the law originates from. It's about something else. And I think this something else is to do with the criminal or penal system in Islam. Where Islam says, you know, cutting the hands of a thief, for example, when the crime is established with all its conditions.
Really? Cutting the hand? You agree with that?
Do you know when it was implemented?
So this man is with his right hand has been cut off. Then he's going to be on the society to look after him until the day he dies.
It has to be.
He was active. He says, "I'm sorry, I've done that because of the situation in the society."
So you agree? Yes. So you agree? Cutting of the hand is severe and harsh. Do you agree? It's very harsh.
No. Yes, harsh.
It's harsh.
It's just.
That's precisely the point of the Quran. It's legislating.
But they're doing it in Saudi Arabia today.
No, no. In Saudi Arabia today. Since the law that is implemented is not 100% Islam in its entirety. That is why this system would not work.
Since 2014 until now, they've beheaded 600 people in Saudi Arabia.
In Saudi Arabia, or in Bangladesh, or Pakistan, or India, or any of the Muslim countries, or Muslim, where they can potentially implement Islam, right? They're not implementing 100% Islam. And if you don't implement 100% Islam, you're not providing the situation and the context to implement a rule in which the rule can be working very effectively. To give you an example, at one time, there was famine. Famine.
Famine, yeah.
Yep. People had no food. There's drought, whatever. If someone were to steal something and they were caught, crimes were established, and yet they didn't get their hands chopped off. And it happened. We know that it happened. It's all documented in one of the caliphs. Why did it happen? It's quite obvious, as explained by them, that the system we have here, a Islamic system model, in which the basic needs were not catered for. Food and sustenance, which should be catered for by the society, even if you couldn't do it by yourself. People were dying of starvation, didn't have their means to get this food to live. So if they went to this last resort of actually getting someone else's food, which is not their own rightfully, to sustain their life, you cannot implement the system. So the system is linked with what?
What it says in the
system
Quran.
Of punishment is not linked with just capital punishment like that. It's linked with the integral whole system as a whole model. Contextualize. Why? Because you have to provide, as a society, the education first. That yes, this is wrong, you shouldn't be doing that. People have to understand that everyone has their rights and you should not violate their rights. Secondly, you have to give them the means of these basic rights. Rights of what? Your food, your shelter, education, your honor and your dignity. All of these have to be protected and maintained, provided. If this fails, then you can't implement the system. So if you have a system where everyone knows, for example, imagine now in Britain, everyone knows that this is a system of punishment where if you were to steal a certain amount which is of this worth in value and you protected it, you don't just leave it aside, you actually locked it, lock and key, away from the reach of easy stealing. And people know that stealing is punishable by cutting of the hands. And the society provided you with this welfare where you don't need to steal for your food. So if it's for food, even if you didn't have any money or anything, it will be the government to provide you. So you have no need. Having all of that means in place, even if you didn't have that, your neighbor is responsible to feed you, to provide you the food, or your friends all around you. So what remains is this.
I was talking about primitive laws.
No. Just take example primitive. Of this harshness. Primitive. Because people think this is very primitive, right? Very harsh.
Four wives. are primitive.
Okay, we'll consider that one in a second. But in a moment. So let's wrap this up very quickly then about punishment.
Women cannot bear witness. That is primitive.
Okay, one moment.
And my daughter is a judge. She stands there and judges you Muslim if you did anything wrong.
My
daughter can judge you.
I would like to deal with your example, but let's finish this example. If the government is a society, if your environment has given you all the means so that you don't need to steal, and then yet you go on to steal again, what does it tell you about your psyche and about something wrong with you? When you have no need and you want to steal, that means you are creating instability, destability in the society, which has given you all that provision for you not to steal.
Right.
Yeah? So you need to be taken care of in a way, look, maybe to make you as an example of a deterrent for those of you who are going to create instability in society, create disorder in society when there is no need to steal, then this is what will happen. Then the next person who considers, I have no need to steal, and he's about to do that, he's going to say and think, my hand's going to get chopped off. You see how it will deter people from doing that? And this is one of the main aim of Islamic punishment system, to deter people from committing this crime by giving harsh punishment.
Yeah.
With this, I would like to give you in the last 1 minute or 30 seconds, how this deterrent works.
Yeah.
If you have a society like here or Sweden, where killing someone incurs 10 British pounds, and what does Sweden have in their currency? Money, yeah? Imagine 10 pounds in Swedish money. If you kill one human being, do you think it's going to stop people from committing this crime? Someone's got 30 pounds in their pocket, he says, or she says, I can get away with 3 murder. That's because that's all 10 pounds each. But if it is like this, murdering someone means if you're caught with the hands of the law and you're tried in the courts appropriately and you're found guilty, you will be punished by death penalty. Then any person who's about to unjustly murder someone, they're going to think twice. If I get caught, I am going to be killed myself by the hands of the law. It will act as a deterrent. That's why there are some punishments which are very harsh.
Stop.
Okay.
From the beginning of Islam until now, 1400 years, show me one Muslim country that has provided all that you're on about, that everybody is so everyone has been provided for, and there's no need for a stealing that results in chopping your head. Show me one country. Was it the Abbasids? Bani Umayyad? No. Bani Umayyad? No. Abbasids? No. The rest of them? No.
Between the Abbasids and Umayyad, how many hands were cut off?
Caliphs, no.
Okay, one second. How many hands were cut off in the Abbasids and Umayyad governments?
In Abbasids' time, I know, since they were ruling in Persia, for example.
Which time period?
At the time of Harun al-Rashid, they were calling the Persians their Mawalis, and they had occupied the country, and they were doing all sorts of things.
How many hands were cut off due to stealing?
In Persia, that time, I wasn't there.
So I would like you to go and research the subject.
I know.
And you will see, you'll be shocked to see. Because when Islam was implemented on a societal level, with all the rights and provisions.
So you think occupation was the right thing to do?
You see,
by our bosses.
My friend, you are now shifting. Wait, don't go.
I don't like the cameras.
Okay. That's fine. What you're now discussing
right? Okay.
I know.
And there is no. I spoke to anybody. I have never been assaulted by my religion. Everybody looks at my religion with respect. I have not known in any reputable historian writing something bad about the historian. Osiris the Great, when he went to Babylon, he went in peace and he never killed anybody. No slavery, no nothing. You look at the Tariq of Baghdadi. Listen to this carefully. You look at Tariq of Baghdadi. Look at Jalil Tabari. Look at Dawoodi, Masoodi, all these historians. They write in that when the Arabs entered Persia, they did a carnage. They actually, they took 1,400 women and they took to Medina to sell in the market at the time of Omar. And
can I read this in a reference point?
600 girls, as they were taken in bandage towards Medina, they actually killed themselves.
I would like to read before I even comment anything on this. So next time, bring some references so I can read about it. No.
Page, volume 4, from 125 onwards, page 125.
Which edition?
Volume 4.
No. Every volume for in a book.
You're right. You go and read some.
My friend, any book, when you say any book, when you provide a volume, you have to provide the edition, which the year which was published, because you can have several volumes published by different editions in different years. So what I would like is bring a copy.
Masoodi and
sure. Bring those references, proper references, so I can read. Then I will comment on it.
But what I would like, you haven't read these books. Have you not?
What I'm saying
is this.
My interest is not history.
All right, let me tell you something.
I'm telling you, my interest is not history.
Let me take it another direction, which is more. Who killed Omar the Caliph?
As I
who
said,
killed him? Hold on. Who killed him?
Between, look.
Answer me.
When it's Islamic,
as a Muslim,
no, my
who
friend.
Killed?
When it's Islamic history,
yeah.
I am not,
you're not his,
well read in Islamic history.
So what do you know?
But I can go and read when I need to. That's what I do.
So you don't know who killed Omar?
Please. What I'm saying, the discussion is this. We were discussing about the punishment system in Islam.
I'm talking about.
And you came with the example of occupation, how Islam or Muslims occupied Persia and how they
beginning I came and said what do you say about those who how you respond to those who say the laws of Islam are based on the primitive Arab culture of the time.
Sure. And that's why I'm saying the laws.
That's all I said.
So the example I've given you.
We can go on for hours.
No, look, I don't need to go on example any for hours. The examples I've given you already, I give you example to show to you the laws of theft and the punishment for it. And I talked about the murder. But I didn't actually go into the punishment for murder and the options provided. If you were to compare this solutions or the punishments incurred by this crime, you will see how this is the most appropriate punishment for a crime of that nature that Islam provides. So it's not about primitive, because it's very much long time ago, as we established democracies very long time ago, but still people want it today. So that's why I'm saying, when we want to know which system is better, we have to compare which system is better for the needs of people, needs of society. So today,
definitely not the Arab culture.
We're not talking about Arab culture. Do you know what? Okay. I agree with you.
Based on it.
I agree with you. Not Arab culture, not Persian culture, not Indian culture or Pakistani or Bangladeshi culture.
Hold on, one minute.
Do you agree?
If my daughter was born in Saudi Arabia or any of these Arab countries, today she wouldn't be a judge. She's only 25, 26
years
old.
I cannot speak for Saudi Arabia. I cannot speak for any other country, because it's not my country.
Yeah, but this is the law of Islam. It says two women, if a crime is committed or something, one woman cannot give shahada. You know that, don't you?
That's not what it is.
That's what it is.
In Islam, there are what we call witnessing, right?
Two women equals one man. As when it comes to show.
No.
So no.
There are places where, situations where, the only testimony that is acceptable is one woman. For example, when it comes to childbirth and so on and so forth, man's testimony was not being accepted because woman's testimony is preferred. Because woman is their specialty and their needs. So when you have a midwife, their testimony will supersede the testimony of any other man, for example. So you are thinking about when a commercial transaction is done, and the Quran says, this transaction, Assalamu alaikum brother, you need to write it down, even though it's how small it is, and then get your witnesses, two men. And if you cannot find two men, then one man and two women. Yeah? That is what you're referring to. I will ask you again, why two men in the very beginning? Are you saying one man witness is not enough?
Apparently, I say one man is enough.
No. Let's Think deeply. The first point Allah says in the Quran is, you have your transaction, get it witnessed. Because later on you will regret if you don't write it down, right? Write it down and have witnesses as well. But get two men to witness. Now ask yourself, why two men? Are you saying one man witnesses half of another man and you need two men to equal one witness? Do you see? The witness requirement is for a reason. Why two men? So when you don't have two men and you only have one man, it says get two women. Because if one of them errs, then the other one can remind her. That's what the Quran says. Now, this is about a commercial transaction. Islamic society, the model it provides, it's not where man and woman mix. They have a different roles in society, different ways of how one caters for the needs of the society to the others. It's not like here, everyone have to work, you know, like a slave in the machinery of economics. Islam doesn't want everyone to work like that. This society post-World War, or just before World War, started working. Women were brought into work, for example, because otherwise the society was totally crumbled by the warfare, right? And it needed both sexes to contribute to bring back again the society in its economics and so on and so forth, right?
So now, what Islam says, so half of the population gets out of the economy.
It doesn't say that. Islam says you don't have to burden a woman to go and work financially like men. Man can do that job. Yep.
Can woman?
Yeah. Look, women are not being forced. If you do a survey and say, look, if everything is provided for you, financially,
It's not possible.
Wait.
In this earth, anyway.
If woman, everything is provided for her, right? Everything. She doesn't need to work.
Of course.
Would she prefer to work and wake up early in the morning and come back late at night to earn the bread? She would probably say, I'll take a break and I'll do what I want to do. Maybe do going shopping, maybe doing research, discovering, you know, medicines and treatments, whatever. Not right just going and work as in work. They would prefer, if you give them an option. Islam says, look, you can't force women to work. But of course, if a society needs it, then you have to provide the environment where they don't mix and match, not match, mix together, and then it creates, you know, the sexual tension. And that happens even in our labs. People don't realize that. Even in the labs people work inside us, sexual tension happens between man and woman. People may say, no, that doesn't happen, but it does happen. If you even,
does happen.
Yeah,
it
okay.
happens because
so let's come back to, I mean, I'm not just saying you don't have to work. If you need to work, work. No problem. When it comes to witnessing, so in a commercial transaction, Muslim women are not necessarily always involved because they don't really go into commercial transactions and so on and so forth. So these things, they might not even remember 40 years later. A dispute arises. You're asking them to remember? Islam says no. Then if you have two women, they can remind each other.
Well,
that's all it does.
Muslim countries are backwards today. No. Show me one successful Muslim country.
You are conflating, my friend, with...
Because half of the population are being put out of the...
I can give you some Muslim countries where,
on,
you know, they're very prosperous.
Go on, one.
Okay.
Which one?
In the Arab Emirates.
Arab
the education
is because of the
wait. Oh, the education system there.
Because of the Americans.
One second.
And the
one second.
And they got
in,
so
in,
much
in some countries,
I'm sorry to say
women
that,
women are more educated than men.
Well,
yeah,
you.
More educated, more, you know. You can actually
Arab
go.
Women, I'm from those areas. I'm very, very.
Perhaps you need to look into it. Perhaps you
I'm
need to look into it.
I'm very familiar.
No, no. Because you're only thinking about, maybe Saudi Arabia, which didn't allow a woman to drive, now it does.
No, that's what you think.
I'm not talking about Saudi Arabia.
No, neither
right?
am I.
I'm not talking about Saudi Arabia.
So, the example you brought there, United Arab Emirates.
I had some examples where I've seen the statistics. I have seen the statistics.
President stands there and says, if I wasn't for me, these countries wouldn't survive 1 week. And you're telling me all this?
Well, look, this is like many other countries. If America wasn't supporting them, they would have already crumbled in their in their political instability and so on. America is protecting them.
America is protecting all of the Islamic countries. Well, the one that
well,
hey, we have money, really.
So when it comes to Islamic systems of societal affairs, how it conducts or wants it to be conducted, laws to do with education, laws to do with, you know, moral education, laws to do with economics, crime, punishment.
It hasn't worked for 1400 years. When it worked, they are slaves of the Americans and the British.
You are
the
talking
French.
About a system none which of them, none later, of them independent, none later of them. When Muslims left Islam
none of them
in its governance,
country.
When Muslims became engulfed with their own desires, that's when the problem happened, and that's why the society, Islamic
when
society,
they had
collapsed.
Some power, when they had some power, like the time of the Abbasids, as you mentioned, they did a lot of wrong things. Afterwards, the Ottoman, you mentioned
Harun al-Rashid's time.
Yeah, I remember.
How was the society then, in terms of prosperity, in terms of advancements in science, in technology, in literature?
Only the top elite, they were having a good time.
And?
The rest weren't.
What were the rest doing?
The rest were begging and...
I beg to differ.
Riding donkeys.
The pun when you said they're begging. Yeah. I beg to differ. I mean, perhaps we need to revisit. As I said, look.
You just said you don't know about history.
That's what I'm saying.
I'm talking about history.
Okay. So where have you read about this? There are lay people who are just begging on the streets like this?
Well, I know. A lot of, people from Europe who went to those areas.
When those Khalifs...
Then they went to specifically... They mentioned Samarra, in Iraq, apparently.
What point of time?
Where, at time of the Harun al-Rashid and Ma'amun and all that.
Yeah.
And people were begging, and that's what they...
When those Khalifs, going in disguise at night time to see who has not been looked after by the Islamic government... That's what they were doing. And they considered to be like... If they found someone who didn't have any food, do you remember the stories?
Look, they had occupied a country and they were milking it.
I know, look, you have a situation...
Harun al-Rashid was milking another countries.
Your main problem, as I understand, is because Islam has gone to certain countries like Persia, Egypt, you consider this to be occupation, and that's your biggest issue.
Occupation.
Yeah, that's your biggest issue.
Don't you believe
that Islam? But if Islam,
right, today,
if Islam
today,
removed people from the enslavement of worshipping themselves to worship the Creator, which is better?
Today the Jews are in Arab land, okay? As Arabs call any Arab land, but the Jews say it's ours. But the Arabs can understand how painful it is to occupy and hurt people. For 70 years, they've been killing, at least on average, 3 Palestinians a day, or maybe more. And they know how painful it is. But they've done that in Persia, they've done that in many other countries.
You're bringing back again how Muslims kill Persians. As I said, I would like to see your references, then I will talk. I'm not going to comment anything. But one thing...